just talk already.
Yeah, more or less.
No, maybe.
Okay, well, do you want me to start over? I mean, that doesn't really matter. I was just going to go off. I have to go through what packages in Debian actually do support MDNS. So unfortunately, web's down, so I can't look at the wiki.
Can you just search that database?
Yeah, the problem is that there's a lot of stuff that has support to varying degrees.
Yeah.
Bugs and so on. But we're just the web being down, with the internet being down, you have the nice opportunity to actually look at the actual global network here using MDNS. So, no distractions.
Yeah, but my biggest problem with all the silicon stuff is that if you install a GNOME or KDE, it gets pulled in, and suddenly you have a service running on your machine.
Mm-hmm. You have a VAPI.
Pardon?
You have a VAPI running.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Basically, I'm not sure many people are aware of this. Mm-hmm. So if you install a laptop with GNOME on it, and you use the wireless at an airport, everybody can browse your machine.
Right. Browse your music. Or, yeah.
There are different services for 0.3% and 1 and a full service. Do you guys pull the full one?
Yeah, there's Avahi.
Yeah, there's Avahi and MDNS.
Right.
I believe Avahi has just the listener else.
I think it does have a listening mode, but I'm not positive about that. So it definitely defaults to broadcasting.
Oh.
I think.
Basically, what I'd like to see is something that starts up and user that wants to use KDE or GNOME, mm-hmm. uses their desktop and that dies when it uses logs out.
Yeah, right.
Won't that be a problem with the bus bindings on ZeroConf?
Yes, it would be a problem. but nevertheless, well, personally, I use Ion. I don't need ZeroConf and all of this at all, but I do have KDE installed still.
Yeah.
Because there might be other persons using my computer.
Yeah.
And, well,
yeah.
I don't feel that comfortable.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I just, I don't know how it's technically possible to do that. Some sort of, I've been thinking along the lines of what we should install by default. Should we try to find a way so that we can install KDE or GNOME without pulling in a body at all? And then if people want to use it, they can at least have, have to actually turn it on by installing it. It's just that there's so many things that depend on it.
It's just a choice.
Yeah.
It should definitely be optional. At the same time, I think it's good to make people not have to think to install it. For example, the KDE meta package should still pull it in, but it should definitely be possible to install parts of KDE without it. You know, it could be like a sub package that doesn't include it, plus the stuff that doesn't include it into the KDE meta package or something. It should be possible to go both ways, but people shouldn't have to know about it to get it.
Yeah, I still think that the overall design is pretty broken. Because basically, for it to work, the user relies on the system service to run, and can install the system service himself. And on the other hand, this is a choice that must be made by the sysadmin for his users. Mm-hmm. Well, the users usually know best what they need.
Right. But I mean, most desktop Debian machines do just have one user, so it's not a big deal.
Also, most sysadmins, if they're doing their job properly, will be talking with the users or whoever decides what they need. And if the sysadmin is not doing the job properly, then there are bigger problems.
Yeah, also missing the master switch. I mean, I could even live with a ZeroConf being installed if there were a system tray icon that tells me system calls and ZeroConf is currently active or is currently inactive.
Right.
my opinion, default to inactive. If the user starts up an MDNS browser, with pop-up window, MDNS is currently inactive. Do you want that?
Yeah, it seems, sounds like Windows, what's the version?
Vista.
Like when you want to open a TCP connection to this port, to this host on port 80, it's like, yes, I'm using a computer. You know?
The point is we're trying to emulate Windows here. We are trying
active.
Well, Mac and Windows.
Yeah, Windows doesn't even do this deal as well as Mac.
Oh, here's some cool music. Cool.
Yeah, but
try once more. It's interesting.
I think we're giving up a lot of control over our computers in favor of some defaults. A lot of decisions have been made for us already. Like, for example, the GNOME file chooser. A lot of people have complained about it that it's getting simpler and simpler, up to the point where you cannot even enter a file name anymore. Because you could just click on the file, but sometimes you don't want to click on the file because typing is faster.
Yeah.
And a lot of decisions are made for us. And I would like to go back into the other direction.
Well, zeroconf doesn't like that makes the GNOME file chooser makes it harder to do certain things. It removes functionality. This, you know, zeroconf doesn't remove functionality, it makes finding other services quicker, but doesn't start making your computer, you know, serve services that it isn't otherwise serving. I mean, the thing Avahi by default advertises any services on your own machine.
I think it does.
It exports some part of the bus subsystem, I believe.
But it doesn't open it, like, if you're not running any services, it doesn't advertise them. I agree it would be good to make sure that it's configurable as to what it advertises or to disable it if you want. Mm-hmm. But maybe the way
to disable is to use some kind of a debus thing or something like that, so you can actually just have it locally use or tell it to turn itself off it already uses all that stuff, so maybe it wouldn't be too much of a leap.
In the typical laptop setup, you have the hotkey. On most laptops, you have a hotkey to enable and disable BIOS.
Right.
Why wouldn't we have a hotkey or at least a system tray to enable and disable zeroconf?
Seems reasonable. I definitely think it should be on by default.
It is an additional service. And if there's a bug in the service, you might not even know you're running it and that you should upgrade.
Well, that applies to so many packages in Debian. That's far from being an specific zero. I mean, Debian in general doesn't provide a notification that there's an upgrade available unless you seek it. That would be good to fix independently. Yeah.
But if you read an advisory that some bug has been found in a body, I don't know what this Avahi stuff is.
If I'm reading advisors, I'm capable of running PS, thank you. I can tell if there's a vulnerability.
Yeah, I mean, if you're running stable, you should be getting security advisories anyway and acting on them. If you're running testing on stable, you should be capable of updating every now and then. That argument, it could be applied to any service whatsoever. Yeah.
But I think the interesting question is whether all this is going to turn into something that's just as commonly expected to have on a network as DNS or TCP/IP. I mean, if people are going to expect it at that level in a couple of years, then worrying about another service running is just as ineffective as worrying that your computer does DNS lookups when you click on a URL. I mean, you see what I'm getting at? There's the potential security holes in every DNS query that you do. There's, you know,
the biggest problem with making it up by default is then it's not zero conf anymore. You have to conf it for it to work.
Yeah, and you might get sued by Amazon for making one click conf or something.
Well, patents are a separate issue, but even they don't make one click the default, but it's a very different context. It's credit card. It's like,
yeah,
it's making your credit card a service, basically, or sort of. But this is not doing anything of the sort.
Yeah. Well, the big problem I think is that the service runs in a system context, right? And would like to see it in a user context.
Uh-huh. Well, do you know of any implementations that run in a user context?
Pardon?
Do you know of any implementations that run in a user context?
Yeah, but...
Also, what would happen if multiple users were simultaneously logged in a desktop environment? Like, let's say it had multiple terminals. Would it have two copies running?
Of the client, perhaps?
No, I mean of the zero conf. Oh, sorry, of the zero conf service advertising.
Yeah.
The
advertising daemon is the problem,
right? So, yeah, and also if you want to be able to advertise things like SSH, that should be true even when no one's not there.
Yeah, sure. Advertisements are a system thing, but as far as I've understood the architecture, everything is done in the same thing, in the same big daemon.
No, clients are
the DNS
lookups.
Yeah, I mean the DNS lookups are the actual service discovery is, I believe, all run by body.
Yeah, because if it ran like this, we could easily drop the depends or whatever it is on the daemon to recommend or even suggest.
Right.
Because most people who install desktop boxes are not running any services on their desktop boxes, so they don't need to advertise that they are not running any services.
Well, actually, there's all the
thing is, that's certainly not the case on systems like macOS 10, where
you have a
printer or music, or iChat, or even K Battleship. I'm not kidding.
Or even clever text editor like Dolby here, or lots of stuff.
Yeah,
I mean, as this stuff, like I've seen. Have you? I know it's a shareware macOS 10 program, but have you seen Subitha Edit? It's a collaborative text editor that allows people to connect to each other.
I assume it's very similar. Which is Gobby.
I don't know Gobby, but I don't think it doesn't look like that.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
chat and text collaboratively.
Yeah, I mean, but not about chat, but like you can actually see what change the other
sure.
person makes.
Yeah,
and it you can find each other via zero copy.
Yep.
Or by telling anybody about the
other. Yeah, I think then the user can start up a small demon that advertises his five services.
That requires a lot more. If it's done right, it might be feasible for the non-expert Linux user, but we shouldn't assume that every Linux user is an expert who knows what zero conf advertising are.
And this thing has network effects, more people use it, the more useful it is to everybody.
Yes.
Yeah.
So,
not every that big user is a dev developer. Ditto for Ubuntu, even more so.
I'm not sure it should advertise printers that are configured to me. Well, these are the printers I have configured. I might be sitting at an airport and telling everybody what are the names of the printers in my office.
Well, presumably, if it's only sitting on local host, it's not going to be advertising something over Ethernet.
Is that, am I right about that?
What's up?
If your printer is only, if your like print server is only sitting on localhost, like on loopback interface, then it won't advertise externally, right?
I don't know.
I would assume. Well,
yeah.
No, I mean, if Cups is set up to listen only on localhost, which I think it is by default on Debian, then Avahi won't advertise it externally because it's not listening externally, right?
I don't know. I mean,
well,
the way this works is it. it actually tells the body what it's doing, so it might be up to Cups to.
Most services, I don't think Cups probably communicate to the body at all.
I'm not sure. I'm not sure what discovery actually.
At least you can see the a lot of printers configured in this network. So
I can't. I can only see two.
I was able to see 3 or 4, but you know.
Well, I saw 3 or 4 earlier.
Yeah.
I think perhaps this is also a design problem in Cups. That a client machine should not be running a full printer daemon.
Or it should just notice that your printer is.
Well, you know, Cups does not.
Actually,
Cups I think does printer discovery through its own browsing broadcasting thing.
Yep.
But at the same time, it's a common misconception. Cups does not advertise your printer by default. It may look for other printers by default, but Cups does not advertise your printer by default.
Yeah.
People get confused about that, and I always do at one point.
I thought that was turn off the advertising when you had to actually.
Yeah.
Turn it on.
So that is not actually an issue with in the case of printers.
Yeah, but in the case of printers, I'm talking desktop, laptop example.
Yes, desktop and laptop it doesn't advertise a printer by default.
Yeah. I would expect there to be some printer server or the printer itself to advertise itself.
It's the printer server that advertises. If it's Cups, it advertises the user.
Yeah.
In a desktop and laptop.
It's not a printer.
Yeah.
In a desktop laptop environment, most people have one computer. They don't have a print server computer and a computer that wants to connect to the printer. Most people have a computer which has a printer hooked up to it, and so it needs a print server or software.
Because
it has to manage pooling and queuing and
data
queuing.
I don't hear what the print computer is. I just asked. I said every first assumption you have is right. Okay? Every precondition. And say that the Cups announce itself, you have some printers.
Oh, back on line.
And then it sends out, okay, I have a printer on my laptop, on the airport. And then I have to ask one more question. What's the problem with that? Because you can't bring anyway.
There is some sort of information beacons up.
Yeah.
Okay, because you may know the name of the printer that would give some information about your internal setup.
Okay.
So that's not
there's
what
there's other information leakages too. Like I was in the Atlanta airport coming down here, and I found all like two guys' names who were somewhere around just by looking at whether Macs are broadcasting on the internet. I could have had them paged or something. You know, there's all kinds of fun you could probably get up to when you have information out.
So from a privacy perspective, everything should just turn off. This is because you can get that kind of security information.
Well, not like everything. It's a way for SSH to say, hello, I'm SSH, that version. Unless it gives you like my domain name is that.
At the same time, since we're trying to serve our users, privacy is definitely important because our users care about privacy. At the same time, convenience is also important, and how do you balance those two? Because users care about both. And obviously, the user should be able to choose their own balance, but setting the default is hard.
Yeah, because we were trying to configure it before, I think the convenience part still has a big problem of the NSS limitation that does lookups in order. So you have to either have MDNS or DNS timeout.
Yeah.
Well, that will hopefully get fixed at some point, right?
I don't know. I've heard some talk of, I can't remember the details about changing how that works. I don't think it's available.
I mean,
right now, Wi-Fi level and DNS lookups might be sort of annoying. So.
I mean, couldn't you make MDNS, will zero conf addresses ever end in anything other than that local?
I think that was one of the ideas, was to hack the DNS resolver so just hard codes that in. I don't think they will want anything other than local.
And MDNS has to be, like, if you put...
There was an idea, you put MDNS first and it just skips over anything that isn't local.
Yes.
And that was discarded, and if you can go back and read the thread, which is against libNSS MDNS.
It's a bug or?
Yeah, it's a bug report saying it should be enabled.
You can browser but not connect.
No, the idea was to skip over, make it skip, have check it first, but make it skip everything that wasn't at all local domain.
So the issue might be that the issue might be that people have it out local in their personal network, maybe?
I don't think that's the issue that came up. It actually caused some kind of network performance issue of some kind, but yeah, I don't remember the details. That's probably a flip as
well. Well, that's not any folks, including one thing that should not be in there by default. And multiple days it is.
Yeah. Well, since I've got the web backup, maybe I should run through everything that even actually does to MDS right now, or that has anything to do with it. Because we've talked about this list. So, of course, we've got a body, which is the daemon. Works okay. We have the zero comp package, which everybody hates because of the network interface issue. And I think that we should definitely make sure that it's installed by default. Right now, one thing recommends it. I think if you install SSMDNS and using it to get installed by default. And until that bug is fixed, that's sort of bad. And then we have SSMDNS, which does the local DNS lookups. Currently doesn't configure itself automatically. We have Apache 2 mod DNSSD, which lets you broadcast web pages or RSS feeds or anything like that. For Apache, you have to turn it all on and configure it. Apache.com, it's not a manual, and it's not an automatic thing. I think that with that you can actually use Epiphany or something and browse the whole network. Jim was trying to do it with Conquer and it didn't work.
I got it to work.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
What did you do?
I don't know, it started working.
Okay. And let's see, you can add stuff like OpenSSH to the network, but they don't have to support. You just drop a file in to the body configuration. I've sort of been wondering if we should do that by default or not. If OpenSSH just come with a service definition for a body so that every machine, you know it has OpenSSH, if that's just pointless exercise.
Is there also a tool that you can run to add, to configure and modify service advertisements without having to edit something by yourself?
If there is, I haven't heard of it. So that would be pretty easy. Actually, there might be. There's a Vahi publish address and a Vahi publish service. So I think these things just make a call to Vahi. You have to tell them all the info. So there's a lot of GUI for it, I know.
Does the announcement even check what the service is actually running?
In the case of the SSH stuff, no. All you know is a static file, and it says, you know, basically we have this port open. I guess the only use for that is like GNOME or KDE. I know that GNOME has some kind of it's called Service Discovery Applet, which lets you like go through a menu of all that stuff so you can log into other machines on the network and stuff, which is sort of nice, I guess, for end users. But then we have Rhythmbox, which now automatically publishes, I think it does it automatically. Publish as well. Oh, it isn't?
No.
Okay, so,
okay.
So the other one on this network actually had to turn it on. I was wondering about that. For some time around broadcasting 30 games of music.
What's all that called?
Not all that called. Maybe I turned mine on too, I forget. I guess that gives them all the body and all that. So I don't remember if that's the only thing that holds it in.
I should mention this by what I said earlier about things being on by default. I do usually turn off iTunes sharing, but that I still think it's reasonable for being on by default. The reason I turn it off is because, you know, in my dorm setting, people generally use iTunes to download the music instead of just streaming it. And that's, if I want to give people music, I want to know about it.
Yeah. I mean, there's obviously privacy issues as well.
Yeah.
I think off by default is pretty good people.
For that, yeah.
I think we should also think about a laptop case where a single machine is probably going to be brought into several different environments, quite likely without rebooting, because a lot of people only suspend on clients, and you might run into the NSX issue again. You might run into issues with caching. Name caching, also negative caching.
I don't think that the NSS DNS module does like caching.
Okay.
I think suggests NSCD will do the caching.
Uh-huh.
I think it does.
I know that.
So if you have that installed, it can do caching. If you don't, it doesn't.
I know for sure that whenever I
they just have one caching daemon for NSS in general.
Yeah.
And if you upgrade your system, you have a big problem with that.
Why?
If the NSS level is changed, all programs that are currently running cannot do any more DNS modules. So you basically have power cycle. Log out the users and stuff. And that's a completely different case from the desktop setting where it would only move the machine when it's powered down. So you might want to think about the laptop case as completely different from the desktop case.
Mm-hmm. Well, anyway, you don't install the caching by default, so it's,
Is the caching that makes that be the case?
No, we're saying restarting it.
But the caching is the only thing for which that what you said about restarting is true, or
no? You have to restart all programs that use NSS, which are any network any tools that use the network. As soon as you upgrade the NSS,
that's only the library's an incompatible version.
Yeah, this happens quite often.
Really? Huh. I've never seen this. It doesn't seem to have anything to do with
and even in that case, you don't need to restart the application for them to keep working. The inode won't be deleted even if you delete the old library for an application.
But the application won't be able to do the lookups.
But with the old library, with the old routines.
They just stop working.
I think the issue might be, would the issue be that the application is trying to load the new library and it can't, or if you've added something to SCNSS switch on conf, it's going to try to dynamically load the new library.
I think the problem was actually that the application would fail, just to try to load the new ones.
I've really seen that Jimmy just turned it on his laptop on the fly and it sort of worked.
It definitely would resolve it without me having to restart things. Or always running command line tools, it's true.
Yeah.
No, I think it's sort of worth, I mean, I've seen that warning a lot too, but I haven't seen it be a problem in practice. I'm sure there are cases, like you say, where it is a problem in practice, but they're certainly not the common case. I'm sure the warning's there for a reason, but it's often not relevant. Yeah.
So basically what I'm wondering about is, should there be perhaps a completely different architecture to it. That would, for example, allow me to switch main server or turn MDNS on and off in the background without any application noticing about this. And should this infrastructure be integrated into ZeroConf, or should we have another tool for that?
It seems pretty independent of ZeroConf to me. It's just how the NSS switch looks. It's fine, basically. ZeroConf can understand it's not or resolve or doesn't change anything else. Anyway, if I can get back to this list of stuff, because I actually want to go through and see what they make about a few things like KDE. Yeah, it's not on my app cache anyway. There's another one, mt-appd. Yeah, I tried it. There's got another IP. Huh? Are you looking for?
So we're hitting travel folders, network services, and then I went to triple dumping service. Then I went to Joey Cast on Dragon and got there.
Anyway, which service do you want to configure themselves automatically? Advertisements of.
Right. Which other ones? Well. Okay.
Should we, for example, have to have
the box? I don't know if Banshee does. It has a plugin that adds MDNS support to it. I haven't checked it out. I believe that there's some known games that do.
Okay.
I know some stuff that KDE does.
KDE Battleship.
Yeah.
I've never played it. It's worth your
apparently Akika does the good, or however you're not supposed to pronounce that, like, known meaning thing. For a while we had a open H2H client being broadcast onto the network here, which is rather interesting. Dobby definitely, by default, it just broadcasts, doesn't work otherwise. And I think that's it. I'm sure there's more stuff inside KDE, maybe it's like GNOME that does, but I don't know what it is.
Should there be a that kind of question when installing an app? What's it, whether it should announce or not?
It might depend on the package to some extent. I mean, if you're installing Dobby, you definitely want to do Clever embedded. I think there's no other reason to install it.
Yeah, basically, there's no other reason to run it. And
exactly.
Unless you're on it.
If you're running it, you're wanting to start up a session.
What if you want to do collaborative editing where you specify who you want to talk to?
It asked me for a password when I started it up, and I wasn't sure if that was my password or if it was a session password.
So you put something different?
Yeah, right now I have no passwords, so someone wants to try to use Dobby and see how that works. We can find out. But,
maybe we need to make a distinction between system services that are they and user services
yes.
that are they announced by default.
Right.
I think that's probably a quite helpful distinction to draw.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't really matter if no games announce that,
right.
that they're running on
yeah.
system by default. If you start a game,
right?
Yeah, but if you start a game and it announces to the world that you're running a game, I would consider that a bit of a breach of privacy.
It really depends on how it announces.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's a breach of privacy to run Quake and tell it to connect to a server and somebody can TCP it up and say you're playing Quake. It's the same thing.
No, if you start a game locally.
Yeah.
You play against yourself.
Well, I assume you're playing good better. Well, or King Battleship is yourself, it's very boring, so.
Yeah, I think
that's true.
there might be other games.
Yeah.
I think a lot of companies, like IT departments, would absolutely love to do
that.
Yeah,
I'm saying the broadcast.
What I'm saying is
they can sniff the network.
Yeah.
So
any game that does any network doesn't matter if it uses zero conf or not, as long as it's
yeah,
zero.
But
I mean, Tetranet has the same issue.
Yeah.
Even if it's not zero conf.
Yeah, but for example, if you have a game that can be played alone or can be played against each other,
mm-hmm.
as soon as you start the game,
well,
it starts broadcasting.
Yeah, but I think that the thing that makes sense in writing a game like that would be you have a button saying, I want to play multiplayer on the network now, or
yeah.
I want to play by myself. And,
yeah. Yeah, but the convenience of people come and said if you start discovering earlier, then we might have found it.
This is a political decision, it's not a technical one. Because of
I think
they
could have an excellent example if we worked
yeah.
on it too, right?
I think the more important question in the immediate future is system level services like SSH and what do we do about those by default?
I think
we should ask.
So, yes, which services does the system accept to zero conf?
Right.
This service
by default.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
they complain about SSHs?
No, SSH doesn't. I mean, SSH has to set up manually right
no,
now.
No, that's okay.
Yeah, right now SSH is all manual.
Okay, so I think that probably makes sense. So the
problem that I haven't really figured out what the I mean, there's obviously some small advantage from using it.
Yeah, it's like nmap running nmap.
Yeah, exactly. You can run nmap.
It's
run
it's the same thing.
So the point is that
but you can detect a scan. You can detect a scan. You cannot see who's using a broadcast.
Right.
But yeah, my question was, which way should the question go? Because it seems like a chicken egg problem. Because we're talking about zero conf, and then if you have a config question, it's not zero conf.
Well,
so,
wait, depends when the question is posed. Is it, it's posed when you start the package, something.
That's the point.
Before using something.
That's the point, because usually in Debian, if you install something, it's enabled because if you install, you need it. That's right. But the point was, should zero conf be have a centralized configuration and enable this one, or package should ask, should I enable myself?
I think there's a limitation that makes us do this per package.
Okay.
We don't have, there is no such limitation.
Well,
you can add
two models. Yeah, you can add two choices and re-ask the question. But as more and more services get added,
then you can just have one question. It's global if you want to.
Yeah, one question with just have a list of just certain generated list of choices dynamically. But
just one question. It's just asks one question.
When you install the
I said, I didn't say one template. I said one question.
Yeah. One question. Do you want services broadcasted?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or do you want system services broadcasted? Or
yeah, do you want system services broadcast by default when you install the VAR? Yeah, that question. Well, then have an updated VAR.deep script or something that allows you to do that. You know, separate to the updates. Updated has been.
But what you are aiming at, I don't get the. So what are you aiming at? You had a question, and it's just stuck in the question. What?
Yeah, the question was, what would be the ideal solution? Do we want to ask people on your installations about whether they want to broadcast this service, that service, and so on, to answer questions? You can ask a single question, but we can have a single question with a lot of choices, which might be repeated over and over again as new packages are installed. And so it's control versus convenience, basically again.
If I install Zero, probably not in some cases, but this is one of them. I would probably accept the host and shallow. I won't answer the question because I don't know what I'm answering. That's the truth, not there.
Yeah.
The other thing, and this is a long thing, if I install the thing and I accept the whole idea, the whole concept, just to be.
Yeah, but I think part of the problem is that you can accept the concept that you might want to route to share your music. Using Rhythmbox, if you turn it on in Rhythmbox, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you want to share your SSH session just because you have to install SSH too. It's it really is two different classes of services, like you said. And so I guess I mean,
but then you have to help people explain what they say yes or no, because if it's then you have the kind of call, because it's a security issue, you can make it a security issue. Be as polite as you can.
Yeah.
And say that you probably want to share the defaults here, you want to share music and two other or three other features that is cool, exceptionally modern, whatever that children loves.
Yeah.
They want to have the kid room and all the guys down the street, they have windows and layout of line, and they want to share music. Let them do that. And you have to find out what's cool features to make a decent sound.
do you want to create a podcast of all MP3s found on your computer? Because that's really cool.
But actually, I do believe that your point has some problems. Because if I recall correctly, Avahi is starting to become a freethisdoc.org project. So it will be like part of the whole integration of intercommunication between packages. And if that's the case, then it's better to have as many services supporting it, because it's kind of an integration stuff.
You need
to
know?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's a big part of the problem. I think the majority of the users don't want to announce stuff, but they do want to find stuff.
Oh, I think that's completely brain dead.
Yeah. That's what I could be.
I'm not sure it's true. Right?
This is kind of things that you have to have 1,000 people to ask.
Right.
And you also have to give them the option to test it and see what they're doing. And you'll find all kind of pattern that you have never seen before.
Yeah. It should also be a properly, I mean, it's possible to just ask a bunch of your friends and get a very few sample, because they happen to be the type of people who would be your friends for any definition of you or friends.
Yeah.
You know.
Need
to be a proper sample.
A sample DevConf, we have something like 9 machines on the network right now that are broadcasting something with Avahi. That's it. Which isn't that much.
But the network was down for several hours.
Yeah,
so
if they turn their laptops off, it is a little bit lower. I think I've seen maybe twice as many, something like that.
Yeah. Peter just unplugged my machine, so.
So going back to the differentiation of services,
yeah.
I do think that the two categories are really, since we're rather limited, so why two categories and not three? Why can I decide that I want to relax on my system services but not, say, the web browser, then the web server?
Right.
So maybe the idea of multiple question in which you sign install a package, you can see the list of what you export and choose, it's not so.
But actually, the fact that on Rhythm Box, you need to choose if you want to share music or not. You can receive music, but you need to choose.
So the point is, where
it's also
a differentiation to whether the user chooses a good time
exactly.
or systems.
Exactly.
I was more concerned about the system service.
Yes.
The user service be a user service and an application choice by the political state. The other choice should be in the system admin space.
Yeah.
And the third thing, well, it has some appeal. I don't say this is right, but to have more than 5 choices is just confusing.
Yeah.
And it's probably more than 4, it's probably better. 3 is probably the best. It's some kind of things between that.
Well, yeah, but
it could be.
There's a system.
Yeah, I agree, but you should install the thing and you have some choice to do that too. Or is it instead of looking at
well, the problem is that lots of people are going to install on the combining that with SSH or with something else that you might not want to broadcast.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you're only running a server and you install SSH and you then install the Avahi DB, you probably want to broadcast it. Otherwise, there's no point in installing it. So, but if you're running a desktop or something, you can install SSH.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Just pointing out that for services on machine which have Avahi, we probably need a finer control of which services are exported via Avahi and which are not.
Yeah.
For the user stuff, I'm fine with being exported by default, and if the application has an option, fine.
Yeah,
but application fault.
Yeah, but at the same time, you don't want to ask the user a lot of questions about it.
But wait, for the service, you don't ask the user. You ask when you install the package. I think the point of their goal is not asking for using stuff, not for configuring.
Yeah.
I mean, when you install the package.
Yeah, the problem is that, as Joey also said, a lot of systems today have one single user. Have one single user, and for most of them, this is going to be the system administrator. So it's the same question that gets asked.
So this actually from what you were talking just now, and it may be a complete rubbish, but this might just me learning Debian. So is there a way like to, for an installation time, to check if the system you, if the package you're installing is called as dependency, dot star the demo, because it's not what the user wants to run.
I missed the condition.
Yeah. So if like, if you pull some package as a dependency, this is not because the user wanted, so the daemon should not be started. And this could be probably generalized to solve many similar problems. And if someone needs the daemon to be working, he should just install it explicitly. Yeah, the written box will just say that I cannot connect to the Abaxi server,
yeah.
So it will notify that it's not starting.
Mm-hmm.
And that it's obvious that the user should do something about that.
But the user case will be the single administrator, single user machine. These people don't want to export the services because they're probably not aware of even running the services. In the majority of cases, and if they voluntarily install a service, then they might just answer the question whether they want to have it exported or not. So we should make sure that on the default install there's as many services installed, and zero-conf just announces nothing. Because there are no services, and then the user logs in, and perhaps starts a K battleship or whatever, and then there's something to announce. I think that'd be the most sane solution for everybody. Because if you have a system administrator that that takes care of things, then these people are probably. Want to be full control of everything, and if it's a large installation, they will precede the DevConf anyway. So it doesn't make any extra work for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a little bit less work. But yeah, I agree that sounds like a same solution. But I don't think, like in current my catch, I don't think any services are owned by default. Maybe a few.
Well, that's why I went through the list. I mean, except for UI, except for end user programs. Or
right. Like if nobody logs in, yeah.
Right.
So I think that's reasonable.
I think one exception to that might be something like DAPD, which is, I mean, it's a daemon.
Yeah.
You only install if you want to share your music.
Sure, yeah.
This was not owned by default.
It wasn't, but it's not a story you want to say. It might be a same or something like that to default to one.
As an example.
Yeah.
It is not on. But
SSH then? Well, no, SSH is a different example.
But you don't
install SSH because you want to broadcast.
Well, I think it makes sense to not enable by default the unattended programs.
Nice.
And
that's to give a single choice when you install a VARG, do you wish to enable system services by default? The admin can override that on a per service basis quite easily because it won't. DevConf won't scribble over the, or the JavaScript shouldn't scribble over the local configuration files. It's good if they do. It's a single question and it's the system administrator's choice. User programs, I think, it's down to the user of the developer. Whether it's fine, as long as the system can modify and control the system services.
Yeah.
In that
which
you
can
do, yes. If you scribble over the conf file, you'll do something like that.
So there should be, in my opinion, there should be a policy or pseudo policy thing that says if you're a desktop environment, do not depend on any services. Like if you're the KDE meta package shall not in any case depend on or recommend SSH, so the OpenSSH server, for example, and should not depend on or recommend any other service that might be announced. So if you install a desktop machine or a laptop, you would not end up installing any services unless you choose to. And then you get asked for those specific services whether you want to announce them, which would be two or three. And you already know what these do and whether you really want to announce them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, we
have
a tool like that.
I mean, I don't know if we even have enough services for it to really matter, because I can't really think of any except for SSH. Maybe, I mean, I'm sure you could broadcast anything and listen to a port, but,
yeah.
You know.
There's a lot of, I mean,
yeah, the web server needs to have separate configuration because it's an Apache module, and you have to tell it which web pages basically to export. It's different for everybody. It's awesome.
Yeah, but it should probably be in the package containing the service, not in the arrive package.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you end up with a lot of interesting new places.
Yeah. Okay. That seems like a decision on that.
What about finding every package, all packages that use 0.5? How did you do that?
I started on the Oahu website, which has this thing called the Oahu Hall of Fame or something. It was written for some German magazine, and it basically lists a lot of different services. And then I went and just looked around for others, and it's not complete because I haven't expanded the section of KE, like I said. And there's a couple of, I don't know if VLC is supposed to use something within the US, but I have no idea what. I haven't been able to figure it out. And GNOME Games is supposed to support HAL, but I don't even know which games. So it's sort of complete.
HAL is no longer dead anyway.
Well, yeah, but I think the Wahi layer, the Wahi HAL support might work. I have no idea if it works. I haven't had a chance to play with those.
It would be interesting to say, okay, we support other video conf with this package.
Right. Yeah, that's what I'm trying to do with this web page here. It's the sort of conf.
Right.
So it's a table.
Okay.
Things that we know work, and things that might work, mm-hmm. and things that I have no idea about, and so on.
Right.
So, yeah. I mean, if it's
basic reference.
Yeah. It just needs to be my name. Make sure that it's not the. There's probably some other programs that you have to support that. I know that you could add it to this CC if you were saying there's a patch.
What?
To this CC?
Yes, how
would I'd like you to pile your software, please.
For example, what's currently happening is the SSH tool of SSH, the client and server transition,
mm-hmm.
and some of the best packages still depend on SSH, which puts in both.
Yeah. Right. But I'm.
So people end up advertising the SSH service that they
right.
probably don't even know about.
And certainly, that's a transitional issue that should get fixed. As far as but on by default, resolve by default, I mean, certainly at least MDNS lookup
mm-hmm.
and service discovery should be something that is available in the GNOME KDE full desktop environments without the user having to know about it.
But the problem being that does mean the service discovery does mean that.
Yeah, that should be this.
Yeah, some services should stop.
That sounds like a bug to me.
I mean, maybe we're building this all proportion. We don't even know what the internals of the daemon are. Maybe the daemon doesn't do service discovery unless a client is connected. I mean, I have no idea. I haven't read the code.
Yeah.
So,
you have it.
You know.
But it sounds like the revolution is to make service discovery a library instead of part of the daemon. Because
mm.
why does it need to be part of the daemon?
I assume caching or something. I have no idea.
And SAD.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's different. Yeah. That's all I can.
The reason I would like to see as part of the user build running
on your system administrator would have to be in the money for you.
Well, I certainly don't see why. I think the library is the right solution for the service discovery,
yeah.
Because, I mean, for all we know, there might be system level programs that a particular user might, or a particular system owner might want to install that might also want to be service discovery. It doesn't have to necessarily be a user level desktop program. And, I might want to push something out to everybody on the network with a certain program open and advertised. But, so therefore it shouldn't be user level program running. But it also shouldn't be in a daemon because there's no need to have a daemon running to look up other computers. So it should really be a library. Yeah.
So I'm just going to write that.
Yeah, well, most likely, yes, I would expect.
Sorry to disturb you guys, but I wanted to say goodbye. I'm leaving early morning. See you guys at the next Capcom.
Yes,
bye,
Manoj.
Bye,
Manoj.
Bunches of W's.
Yeah, full support 54321. Let me see if I can if I just change it to like 60,000 or something, whether it will still work. Or...
It's more on W.
Yes,
yeah.
It does.
I definitely see whenever you sort stuff up. It's actually pulling stuff off the network. I just hashed it. So.
thought we decided that it would be good to have like a an Avahi global question defaulting to no, saying do you want to advertise some services by default?
I mean, I'd be fine with that.
Yeah.
And then
just have a tool like you actually want to enable this.
Yeah. Yeah. The only problem with that is, I mean, it would be sort of annoying if you get it on the default desktop installing if they aren't installing any system services. But
what do you mean?
It'd be better if the system. The question will only ask if a service that could actually broadcast with Avahi came up on just Avahi were installed.
Right.
So it'd be better if SSH asked if it was installed, kind of thing, even if it is just one question.
Yeah. Like if the question had been seen yet,
yeah,
right?
Exactly. Yeah.
If the question had been said,
yeah,
it would ask
right.
it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You might want to ask the general question is required for medium and for individual services low.
Yeah. Well, no. The idea, as I understand Joe's idea, is still to have only one question, but have it not be asked until both the service that needs it and the body are installed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right.
That as well.
Yeah.
But so if you install the first service, you get out. What do you want to do in case you do not see any other questions again? Like if you use it.
Right. What's the default?
Yeah. What's the default and what?
I'm happy for system services. I'm happy with defaulting now unless I mean although you're right, certain specific services like that you might.
Yeah.
Well, even there it doesn't.
Yeah. If you get compared to.
Then
you might want to know about each specific service.
Yeah.
If it's medium, then you might want to go with the default. And if you don't want to, answer the subject of question while installing packages, then low is probably.
I think it's fine to just have a default and have a command line tool to update it because we don't need to have every package have a dead pop template.
I agree. I personally just do packers.
Yeah, not even
that off by default.
Yeah.
The only problem with that is users who might actually want to broadcast, you know, might want to have this set up by default since it's used for the SSH machines.
For larger installations, it might be a good thing to have explicit questions about each service so people can please need them.
Mm-hmm. Maybe just a question in the Avahi package, but priority low or medium, whichever. Because, like, I think machines that are installed nowadays have, they install the default of high, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if we make it a priority medium, it'll default to no and nothing will be done without letting them know.
Right? Priority medium for the default?
And then
no for
no, priority medium for the default command line tool to vary it in a specific case. There's no need to have a depth question in every package. Kind of like the Apache 2 module enabled, disabled, that sort of tool.
Yeah.
Yeah. That would be a little, that would be a nightmare to manage.
Yeah, it's a different use case. For Apache, you have a limited service. Well, for this installation, you would have perhaps 10,000 machines, and you want to you just roll out the single installation with pre-seed.
It's not, that isn't really. That's not. I can't see that actually being a problem in practice, even for a large installation. And I do a help admin in a large installation, and I can't see that ever being a problem in practice.
Yeah.
Like we would in a large installation, you would know what all the machines are, especially if you're pre-seeding them. You would know what the machines are, and you'd know which ones you need to SSH to, and you need to look up zero.
Yeah,
you know,
highly
valuable.
You should have a method for central config file management.
Yeah, I don't see this actually being an issue in a large. In a large network.
But it's another hack for installation, basically. You need to SSH to each machine and enable it with the command line tool.
You can pre-seed enable with the command line tool if you want to.
Well, I mean, okay, so what? So the question instead could be, the question instead of being a yes-no, it could be a, what services do you? It could be one question saying, what services do you want to have on by default, or what services do you want to have advertised by default? leave blank for none, put it all to make the default for all services, or specify a space separating list of services, and that that could be preceded, and not every package would have to worry about it. Does that make sense?
Might work.
Yeah. That's a reasonable compromise.